Thank you. All that for a writer. You guys don't get out much, do you? Now, this is great, and I really appreciate the chance to be here. I've been a George Mason basketball fan for a long time. And that's no hype. I always used to have him in the Final Four on my little bracket. And one year, everybody thought that I was a genius. And that was a that was a good year. I just didn't tell people that I always had him. You know, it's like, well, we won't go there. I was going to say something about a stop clock being right twice a day, but that would put the wrong spin on it, and I don't really want to do that. But I'm really grateful to get an award, and when I get a big hand like that, I never know if it's because you like the work or because I'm here and I ain't dead yet. So, anyway, but it's strange for me because, you know, writers are really not supposed to be recognized or to be famous or renowned, and we're supposed to be the secret agents, and it's strange. I can remember going to Fenway Park probably, I'm going to say maybe 10 years ago. My kids were smaller then, and one of my sons said, you know, you're always getting bothered. Why don't you put on a pair of sunglasses? So I did, and this little eight-year-old kid says to his mother, look, Ma, it's Stephen King in sunglasses. So that was that. But the first time that I ever knew that something was changing in my life, I went on a book tour for a book called The Dead Zone. That was the first time that anybody... It's like Stephen King's greatest hits. So pray for... But don't stop. I mean, I love it. But that was so long ago. I was on the road with Kitty Kelly, who'd just written a book about Frank Sinatra. My mother used to call him Frankie the Snot, and she used to say, he'll never be Bing. And Jerzy Kosinski. And what a shock when Jerzy Kosinski committed suicide, because I thought that he was the most cheerful, magnetic, wonderful guy. You'd go out and spend all day scarfing media, small town media, small city media, which is what you were supposed to do. We were definitely on the chicken circuit. And he always made you feel like you'd just blown the tread off a Russian tank at the end of the day, and he'd grab you and give you a big hug. But I discovered that what the tour is, basically, in those days there were these things. A lot of you won't know about these things. They were very old now. They were called newspapers. And the idea was that the newspaper would ask you into Cleveland or Cincinnati or maybe Austin, someplace like that, and you would go to a dinner, but before the dinner, you would scarf every bit of media that you could possibly get. You'd do the local magazines, and you'd do, there was always an AM program, whatever it was. It was AM Cleveland or AM Albany or AM something or other. But whatever it was, it meant getting up at 5 o'clock with a hangover from the night before and going in and talking to somebody and doing that. And you did it all day long, and the day climaxed with the newspaper's dinner, where you ate what Jerzy Kosinski used to call beige food. It was always chicken or fish, and there was always this sort of pallid gravy. And so I was in Pittsburgh, and I did all this stuff, the AM Pittsburgh and all the rest. It was near the end of the tour. And the last act was dinner up on this thing that's called the incline. No way to get down. You're just sort of stuck up there. And this is the part of the story where I have to be careful. I have to choose my words very carefully. There's this thing called Montezuma's Revenge, where you have to visit the nearest convenience early and often. And this restaurant where we were had a grandiloquent bathroom, but there were no doors on any of the stalls. And it was the low point in my life, rushing in there and sitting down, and the whole tour came out. You know what I'm saying? And I'm thinking things can't get any worse. And there was a washroom attendant who was roughly 150 years old, slowly turns and looks at me in the stall and starts walking toward me with a pad and a pen. He says, "Aren't you Stephen King?" First time I was ever recognized. Anyway, he said, "I saw you on AM Pittsburgh. Can I have your autograph?" So I gave him the autograph. But the thing about being a writer is people look at you. You know, you guys really, at some point, have got to give yourselves a hand. You're out on Friday night because of books. I mean, for Christ's sakes, clap. Books. The most potent weapon against the assholes of the world, books. Throw your brain into gear, turn off Dancing with the Stars, and read a book. Why not? I mean, even compared to a movie, go out, buy a book, $26. I mean, if you went to a movie, the tickets alone, the popcorn, and then you come home, the babysitter, the parking, don't get me going. Anyway, so, but the thing about us is people look at us and they know us from somewhere. If you knew how many times people had walked up to me and said, "Aren't you Steven Spielberg?" And I always say, "Yes." Because I want to get along. I'm an obliging guy. When I was a kid, my mother used to say, "Steven, if you were a girl, you'd always be pregnant." So, it's probably true. Oh, God. Toward the end of her life, I can remember her saying to my brother and I, we'd had any number of girlfriends. She said, "You boys were either awfully lucky or awfully polite." But the best, I'm going to move on from here. I don't want to take too long on this, but the best thing that ever happened to me in terms of the whole idea of being famous was in Nathan's Hot Dogs in New York. I went in, now get ready for it. I mean, I went in, I ordered a hot dog and some sauerkraut and a Coke or a Pepsi, whatever it was. And I'm having, this was around the time of the Dead Zone when I still grew a beard because the beard was black, you know? And instead of all, you know, sort of old guy. I mean, I know I'm an old guy. I had a birthday the day before yesterday. '64, I'm in a fucking Beatles song. It beats being dead. Like the guy says, you get out of bed in the morning and put out your elbows. If you don't bump wood, you're doing okay. So I'm in Nathan's, and I'm eating my hot dog, and there's a pass-through into the kitchen. I see the cook back there looking at me. And he sees me looking at him. He's like right away doing his thing. Pretty soon he's looking again, and I'm thinking to myself, he knows who I am. So finally, he came out and said, "Aren't you Francis Ford Coppola?" And I said yes, and I signed him an autograph. But it's strange to realize, you know, in your old age, somewhere between, you know, there are three ages of man. There's youth, there's middle age, and you look fucking great. So, and I've reached the third age, and At some point, I became, not through any big master plan, America's boogeyman. And Halloween is my least favorite holiday. But, I think what happened was Boris Karloff died, and then Alfred Hitchcock died, and finally even Rod Serling died. They said, kid, you got the job. So I said, does it pay? And they said, yeah, man, it pays. So, but questions come with that, you know, and people want to know how that happened, you know. And they come at it in this oblique way, you know. They'll say, what was your childhood like? What were you like as a kid? This is, you know, the curse of Freud. What they mean is, what fucked you up so badly that you turned out the way that you did? And the answer is really nothing. Well, with the possible exception of, when I was 8 or 9, our bedtime story was Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. That's true. That was what, and what I remember, okay, and this to me is almost like the basis of what I do, not on purpose, but just because I'm drawn that way. I used to say, when people would say, why did you choose to do what you do? I would say, what makes you assume that I had any choice? And what I remember about Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde is, in one of his Mr. Hyde periods, he's walking along the side of the road, and a mother and a young girl are walking, a little girl maybe 6, 7 years old, and Mr. Hyde walks right over her, knocks her down and walks over her, and her bones are breaking and snapping. And the little girl is screaming, and Hyde turns around and walks over her again. I never forgot that, and I guess maybe it might have twisted me a little bit, but who can say for sure? But my mother used to say, and this is really the basis of it, she'd say, think of the worst thing that could happen, and then whatever happens will be better than that. Only somebody from New England could really think that way, but it sort of became my mantra, you know. It's sort of, I would think of the worst thing and I would try to articulate it. It's made me a lot of money. It's also made me a little bit paranoid. It's like, we're all here now together and we're having a wonderful time because we're together. But later you will have to go out in the dark where you parked your car, and it's a true fact from, well, I say a true fact. People say that immediately. The audience assumes you're talking bullshit, so. But anyway, it's a statistical probability that 1 in every 50 of you have left your car unlocked. You forgot to lock your car. And I think the chances are very small that a psychotic person could even now be in the parking lot trying doors. But if there was a psychotic person, the chance that he would have a very large knife are greater, proportionally greater, than that he would not. And that's why I think it would be very wise to check your car, front seat, back seat, trunk maybe, before you get in. But of course, 1 in 75 forgets to lock the house. And and you know, if there was a psychotic, I'm just saying, if there was, and if your house was unlocked, I don't want you to think about this later on. Don't put it right out of your mind. But if you did, the place that they go is the bathroom. So you might be asking yourself now, do I have an opaque shower curtain? Because if you do, that's the place where they would go. If you have a transparent curtain, they'll go behind the door. Now, I never worried about that. I would always check my car and stuff, but I never worried about the leaving the house unlocked, because I'm the kind of person who has to go back 4 times to check the oven. Did you leave the oven on? I'm just, you know, paranoid by nature. That's the way that I am. But so where do you get your ideas? People ask, well, you know, that's the question that writers always make fun of because you're scared of it, because you're afraid if you think about it too much, you won't have any more. But my ideas usually come from a combination of what if and what's the worst, absolute worst thing that could happen. There are exceptions to the rule. There's a story called The Body, which became a film, Stand By Me. And that was, thank you. I loved writing that story. It was, I wrote it in a garage, actually. It was the middle of the summer, it was hot, and I was thinking about all the bullshit my friends and I got up to when we were kids. And there are parts of that story, a lot of parts of that story, that are actually true. And then, of course, there are a lot of stuff that's absolutely made up, because when you're a fiction writer, if he's talking to you, if his lips are moving, he's lying a little bit. Those insurance statistics, total bullshit. Actually, a lot more than 1 in 50 leave their car alone. But a lot of the other stories were things where I was thinking, what's the worst thing that can happen? I wrote a book called The Stand. I was in Colorado. That book has been very strange. Every time another disease comes along, the sales spike again. They spike like a fever. But I was listening to religious radio from out of Arvada, and this preacher was saying, once in every generation, the plague will fall among them. And I had a cold. And I'm thinking, of course, what's the worst thing that can happen? Well, what if everybody dies? But because I'm an optimist, I said, well, almost everybody. There'll be a few people left, like guys like me. But so that came from that. And Cujo, I'm a biker. I started off, as so many ignorant people do, with one kind of bike before finally moving up to Harley Davidson, which is a real, it's American, what can I say? But I did have a bike that was not a Harley Davidson, and it started to miss and skip, and I couldn't seem to fix it. And this postman in town said, well, there's a guy up around Seven Maples Farm who will be able to fix that for you if you can get it up there. And I said, well, why don't I give it a shot? And I took the bike, and it was fine for a little while. And this farm, which had a garage attached to it, was way out in the middle of nowhere. And just as I got up into the driveway, the bike quit. And it rolled to a stop, and I thought, well, I got here. At least that's... And then this St. Bernard came out of the garage. It was the biggest thing you'd ever seen in your life. And I was out in the open on a motorcycle, and the guy who ran the farm came out and said, well, don't worry about Lucky. He's great with people. And Lucky starts, you know... And his hindquarters bunched down, and he was going to go for me. And the guy had, a socket wrench, and he just whipped it down on the dog's hindquarters. And the dog shrank down, and that was it. And he looked at me, and there was not a word of apology. He said, Lucky just must not like you. But the incident kind of stayed in my mind, finally, I wrote a book about it. And I want to mention one more, and I'm going to read something new for you. But I can remember one time, around the time that The Stand was winding up. I was in Colorado, and again, it was a case of car trouble. This time, it was a transmission in an American Motors Matador. Basically, it fell out on the street, and the tow truck came, and I had to walk home. And I cut through a park, and there was a little wooden bridge in the park, and I walked over the bridge, and I had on a pair of boots, sort of like these, except classy. And the heels made this sort of hollow clunking sound on the boards. And I thought of a story called The Three Billy Goats Gruff that I knew from childhood. Who's that trip-trapping on my bridge? And I got to thinking about how that's basically the nut of everything that scares us. Who is that trip-trapping on my bridge? Who's just taking notice of us? What awful thing might be closing in? And I started to think on that walk home about all the things that had scared me, all the monsters, all the things in the movies. And I started to think that I would like to write, since I'd started to get this reputation as the horror meister. I hate that. You can't even be a mister when you get into horror. You're demoted to Meister. The Horrormeister is better than the Schlockmeister, but I've been called both. But anyway, so I started to think about all these monsters, and I thought I would like to, if I'm going to get this reputation, wouldn't it be great to write a story that had all the monsters in it, just sort of a final exam on all the things that scare people. You put in Frankenstein and the mummy and the werewolf, Rodan, all the Japanese monsters, everything. Put it all in. Get it all in there. The vampires, everything. And I will call this book It, because that's the basis of horror to me, is just that it. We don't know what it is. And my wife said, "That's crazy, Steve. Don't do that. The critics will call it shit." They will say, "It is shit." And I said, "Well, yes, probably they will, but I'm going to call it It anyway." And I was thinking, well, what's the scariest thing of all? It ought to be something that children see that scares them more than anything else in the world. I said, "I'm going to make it a fucking clown." And it worked out well. I even scared myself. So I can tell you where some of these things came from, and when I'm in front of an audience, I can, you know, some of these things, if they say, "Where do you get your ideas?" I can say some, but there are certain things that this is what the mystery is of what I do, what you do if you write, and one of the really wonderful things, the unquantifiable things, is if you ask me about some of these other books, I don't know, I don't remember where they came from. The Dead Zone, I don't know where that came from. Just at some point, I felt like, oh shit, I don't know. I just wrote it, The Green Mile. Look, I had this pervasive image of a guy in a prison who was pushing a cart full of candy and sandwiches and this sort of thing. And the people that he was servicing in the cells were condemned prisoners. And they were on this green corridor. And that's really all that I had when I started it. And that eventually didn't even show up in the book, although the guy pushing the cart eventually morphed into John Coffey, who was the guy. I've got a book coming out in about a month. It's called 11-22-63, and it's about a man who discovers he calls it a rabbit hole in time, and he's able to go through this, and you always come out at the same place, 2 minutes before noon on September 9th, 1958, and this friend of his gets him to commit to the idea of going through this and living in the past and stopping Lee Harvey Oswald from killing President Kennedy, because he claims that that's the moment that changed everything. And I originally tried to write that book in 1971 or 1972 when I was teaching school, and the research requirements were too much for me at that time. And I'm really glad I didn't try to write it then, because 71 was still, that wound was still very fresh. For people of my generation, I was barely 17 when Kennedy was assassinated. That was our 9/11. And I can remember around 1970 or 71, I was teaching school, and there was this ongoing conversation, as there has been ever since, about whether Oswald acted alone, whether he acted at all, whether there was a conspiracy, this, that, and the other thing. And there's a book called Oswald's Tale by Norman Mailer, where he speaks very eloquently about that. And he talks about how when he went into writing the book, he was convinced that Oswald was what he claimed to be, which was a patsy, and that there was some sort of a conspiracy that had been papered over. And when he came out of working on the book, which involved traveling to Russia and doing thousands of interviews, he became convinced that it was the truth, that Oswald did act alone. And he says at one point in the book, and I quoted this at the start, is that if you believe in a world where one lonely, unbalanced man can bring down the leader of the most powerful nation on earth in the midst of his security and his retinue, then you believe in a universe that's absurd. And that's one of the reasons why so many people refuse to believe that. They'll believe that there was a gunman on the grassy knoll. They'll believe that there was a gunman in a sewer that was watching with a periscope, that somebody was in Dallas County Jail shooting from the third floor, from boxcars, E. Howard Hunt, blah, blah, blah. There was even people who believed for a while that there was no Oswald, that Oswald was a clone, that he was a Russian agent who had been fixed up in some X-Files way to look like Lee Harvey Oswald. And they convinced his widow, Marina Oswald, who's still alive, that this was the case. So they dug him up and they did the DNA, and it was, of course, it was Oswald. So anyway, I think that we were talking about that in the teacher's room, about the number of coincidences that would have to be involved for Oswald to be there. It almost seems malignant, because at that point, so many things were at a tipping point and could have gone either way. So I thought it would be fun to write the book and see what happened. But I can't remember exactly where I got the idea. What I want to read isn't from that book, because thank God I'm not on a book tour. I'm going to be on a book tour in about a month, and I'll eat beige food, and I'll get the media and everything. But I feel like you guys are my friends, and I don't have to sell you anything. Thank you. God knows you've bought plenty and put our kids through school, and that's a wonderful thing. But for me, you know, I live in relative isolation most of the time, and to get out and to get this kind of response is always humbling, because there's part of me that also wants to please people. I guess if I were a girl, I would always be pregnant. Anyway, I can tell you that this is an idea that I've had for some time. And I wrote a novel in the 70s called The Shining. And God, it's like being Leonard Skinner, you know? Play Freebird. Or maybe the Grateful Dead. But anyway, I always wondered what happened to that kid, Danny Torrance, when he grew up. And every now and then, you know, people will say to me sometimes, they'll ask, one of the other questions they'll ask, do you keep a notebook? Do you keep an idea notebook? And I don't, because I think it's the best way in the world to immortalize bullshit and really bad ideas. If you don't keep a notebook, a kind of Darwinian process takes place, and the bad ideas just, they go away. But the good ones, the important ones, the ones that are important to me, they stick around, they bounce back up every now and then. I kept wondering, what's Danny Torrance doing? What's going on with him now? Where did he go from after this terrible experience? And little by little, this story started to form, and it's almost done. The book isn't finished yet. It's called Dr. Sleep. And I think with the blessing, it will get done. And this kind of goes back to what's the worst thing that you can think of? And it's funny how an idea like that worms into your mind and you start to look at perfectly ordinary things and they start to look sinister to you. And I thought, well, I knew that there were bad people in this story that were like vampires, only that what they sucked out was not blood, but psychic energy from special people like Danny Torrance. And I came to realize that these people were called the tribe and that they move around a lot and that their leader is this woman who calls herself Rose the Hat. They all have these kind of pirate names because pirates are sort of what they are. And I thought, well, how did people like that get along? How do they move? And I realized, you go on the turnpike. The most sinister thing out there, on the turnpike and at rest areas, are RVs. They're the RV people. So this is from Dr. Sleep, and this is about the tribe, and this is about the RV people, and it comes from many years of eating exhaust, I guess. The tribe owned whole towns in Maine, Florida, Colorado, and Arizona, but they never stayed in those places for long. Mostly they were migratory. If you drive the turnpikes and main traveled highways of America, you may have seen them. Maybe it was on I-95 in South Carolina, somewhere south of Dillon and north of Santee. Maybe it was on I-80 in Montana, in the mountain country west of Draper, or on 301 in Florida, outside of Ocala. How many times have you found yourself behind a lumbering RV, eating exhaust and waiting impatiently for your chance to pass, creeping along at 40 when you could be doing a perfectly legal 65 or even 70, and when there's finally a hole in the fast lane and you pull out, holy God, you see a whole line of those damn things, gas hogs driven by bespectacled golden oldies who hunch over the wheel, gripping it like they think it's going to fly away. Or maybe you've encountered them in turnpike rest areas, when you stop to take a leak, stretch your legs, maybe drop a few quarters into one of the vending machines. The entrance ramps to those rest stops always divide in two, don't they? Cars in one parking lot, long-haul trucks and RVs in another. Usually the lot for the big rigs and RVs is a little farther away. You might have seen the tribe's rolling motorhomes parked in that lot, all in a cluster. You might have seen them walking up to the main building, slow, because most of them look old and many of them are pretty darn fat. Always in a group and always keeping to themselves. Sometimes they pull off at one of the exits where there are plenty of gas stations, motels, and fast food joints. And if you see all those RVs parked at McDonald's or Burger King, you keep on going because you know they'll all be lined up at the counter. The men wearing floppy golf hats or long-billed fishing caps. The women in stretch pants, always powder blue, and shirts that say things like, ask me about my grandchildren, or Jesus is king, or happy wanderer. You'd rather go half a mile farther down the road to the Waffle House or Shoney's because you know they'll take forever to order, mooning over the menu, always wanting their quarter pounders without the pickles or their Whoppers without the sauce. Asking if there are any interesting tourist attractions in the area, even though anyone can see this is just another nothing three-stoplight burg where the kids leave as soon as they graduate from the nearest high school. You hardly see them, do you? They're just the RV people, you think? The ones living out their retirement on the road, staying at campgrounds where they sit around in their Walmart lawn chairs and cook on hibachi grills. They're the ones who always stop at flea markets and yard sales, parking their damn RVs nose to tail, half on the shoulder and half on the road, so you have to slow to a crawl in order to creep by. They are the opposite of the motorcycle clubs you sometimes see on those same turnpikes and main-traveled highways, the mild angels instead of the wild ones. They're annoying as hell when they descend en masse on a rest area and fill up all the toilets, but once their bulky old bowels finally work and you're able to take a pew yourself, you put them out of your mind, don't you? They're no more remarkable than a flock of birds on a telephone wire or a herd of cows grazing in a field beside the road. Oh, you might wonder how they can afford to fill up those fuel-guzzling monstrosities, because they must be on fixed incomes, you think. How else could they spend all that time driving around like they do? And you might puzzle over why anyone would want to spend their golden years driving all those endless American miles between hoot and holler or shit and shinola, but beyond that, they probably never cross your mind. And if you happen to be one of those unfortunate people who has ever lost a kid, nothing left but a bike in the vacant lot down the street, or a little cap lying in the bushes at the edge of a nearby stream, you probably never thought about them, did you? Why would you? No, it was probably some hobo, or worse to consider, but horribly plausible, some sick bastard from your very own town, maybe your very own neighborhood, maybe even your very own street, some sick killer pervo who is very good at looking normal and will go on looking normal until someone finds a clatter of bones in the guy's basement or buried in his backyard. You'd never think of the RV people, those sweet grandmas and grandpas in their golf hats and sun visors with the applique flowers on them. And mostly you'd be right, because there are thousands of RV people, but by 2011, there was only one tribe left in America. They liked moving around, and that was good, because they had to. If they stayed in one place, they'd eventually attract attention, because they don't age like other people. Apron Annie or Dirty Phil, rube names Ann Lamont and Phil Caputo, might appear to age 20 years overnight. The little twins, P and Pod, the youngest ones, rube names Peter and Preston Gavin, might snap back from 22 to 12, the age at which they were turned. You can see how stuff like that might raise some questions. A tottery, grumpy old lady of 80 suddenly becomes 60 again. A leathery old gent of 70 is able to put away his cane. The skin tumors on his arms and face disappear. Black-eyed Susie loses her hitching limp. Diesel Doug goes from half-blind with cataracts to sharp-eyed, his bald spot magically gone. Steamhead Steve starts walking in a crook-backed shuffle at the same time his wife, Baba, is able to ditch her continence pants and go out line dancing. People would wonder, and people would talk. Eventually, some reporter would turn up, and the tribe shied away from publicity the way vampires supposedly shy away from sunlight. But since they don't live in one place, and when they stop for a while in one of their bought and paid for towns, they keep to themselves, they fit right in. Why not? They wear the same clothes as the other RV people. They wear the same El Cheapo sunglasses. They buy the same souvenir t-shirts and consult the same AAA roadmaps. They put the same decals on their Bounders and Winnebagos, touting all the peculiar places they visited. I had a ball in Cocker City, Kansas, home of the world's largest ball of twine. And you find yourself looking at the same bumper stickers. Old but not dead. Save Medicare. I'm a conservative and I vote. While you're stuck behind them, waiting for a chance to pass. They eat fried chicken from the Colonel and buy the occasional scratch ticket in those easy on, easy off convenience stores where they sell beer, energy drinks, country and western CDs, and 10,000 kinds of candy bars. If there's a bingo hall in the town where they stop, a bunch of them are apt to go on over, take a table, and play until the last cover-all game is finished. At one of those games, Greedy G, Rube named Greta Moore, won $500. She chortled over that for months, and although they all have all the money they need, it pissed off some of the other ladies to no end. If one of them happens to get stopped for speeding or some other minor traffic offense, it's rare, but it does happen. The cop finds nothing but valid licenses, up-to-date insurance cards, and paperwork in apple pie order. No voices are raised while the cop's standing there with his citation book, even if it's an obvious speed trap. The charges are never disputed. All fines are paid promptly. America is a living body. The highways are its arteries, and the tribe slips along them like a silent virus. But there are no dogs. Occasionally, ordinary RV people travel with lots of canine company, usually those little dogs with white fur, gaudy rhinestone-studded collars, and nasty tempers. You know the kind. They have irritating barks and ratty little eyes full of disturbing intelligence. You see them sniffing their way through the grass in the designated pet walking areas of the turnpike rest stops, their owners trailing behind, plastic doggy bags and pooper scoopers at the ready. In addition to the usual decals and bumper stickers on the motorhomes of these ordinary RV people, you're apt to see yellow diamond-shaped signs reading Pomeranian on board or I heart my poodle. Not the tribe. They don't like dogs, and dogs don't like them. You might say dogs see through them to the sharp and watchful eyes behind the cut-rate sunglasses, to the strong and long-muscled hunter's legs beneath the polyester slacks from Walmart, to the sharp teeth beneath the dentures waiting to come out. They don't like dogs, but they like certain children. Yes, they like certain children very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We're going to have question time now. You see, I haven't answered them all. Shall I stand with you? Can we?
Wherever.
No, it doesn't. I thought it might. Weak, weak. Sorry.
Do you think children should have reading material censored?
Well, I think their parents damn well ought to be able to say what they read and what they don't say. And, you know. And I also think that since all the taxpayers chip in money for the school, that there ought to be some input, but they ought not to be assholes about it. You have to be careful because it's a slippery slope.
Do you believe in ghosts?
Do I believe in ghosts? Well, let me put it this way. I never saw the North Pole, but I believe in that. Jury's out. I'm a ghost agnostic. But I believe in them in stories.
How do you think Dean Koontz feels about always being second best?
Well, first of all, I don't think that he does. And Dean Koontz is a terrific guy, and beyond that, I don't think I want to comment. This is a real briar patch tonight.
I selected these for entertainment value.
Yeah, I can tell. For maximum discomfort on my part.
I didn't envision that. All right, so we'll shift gears then. Who inspired you to write?
Oh, who inspired me to write? There were a lot of people that I read. I think, in some ways, the biggest motivating force, to begin with at least, were the horror comics from the 50s. And I read those and I was terrified. And I thought, maybe I could do that too. But I think that for most writers, when you're young, the real sort of light breaks when you read a book that maybe isn't that good and you say, I could do better than that. And then you feel inspired to try. I don't know. I was inspired by, I think that I loved reading so much that it became almost second nature to write.
Follow-up to that, actually. Do you ever worry that as an avid reader, you'll unintentionally recall someone else's words in your own work?
No, I don't think you can ever. That's called plagiarism, actually. Because
yes, there's a word for
that. It's difficult to believe that you can, and when I do it, I prefer to call it homage. But I think that we have to realize that we're all part and parcel of what we read, and every now and then something will come up where you just kind of want to put the heel of your hand against your brow and say, stop it. I had spent a year and a half writing a book called Under the Dome before somebody pointed out to me that there was a dome over Springfield in the Simpsons movie. And I just kind of went, oh, shit, everybody's going to think I copied it. I never saw the Simpsons movie, and I can hear you out there saying, right, you never saw the Simpsons movie. But I really never did.
This question is written in a very feminine hand and has a kind of certain tone to it.
Nice.
Your stories have found my, quote, dark spot, close quote.
Wait, is that close to any other spots?
I haven't gotten to the question part yet.
I'm full of questions already, but go ahead.
What novel or story found your dark spot?
I would say probably in the early days, there were some of the Edgar Allan Poe stories and some of the H.P. Lovecraft stories, like The Rats in the Walls, the Lovecraft story, The Telltale Heart by Edgar Allan Poe. Those were stories that hit me close to where I lived. There was a story in one of the horror comics about a couple driving through a town and seeing a likely-looking restaurant and stopping in and then realizing that in the mirror on the wall, they're the only people that are there. All the other customers and the wait staff, they don't reflect in the mirror because they're all vampires, and they turn out to be dinner. And in the last scene, the couple is hung from their heels with spouts coming out of their neck, and everybody's lining up. See, it works. Still works. It's old, but it's good. But I think the one that hit me closest to where I live was Lord of the Flies, the William Golding story. Because when I read it, I was a boy myself, and I related to the idea of boys as with a very, very thin veneer of civilization, because that was my friends and me.
When is your biography on Benjamin Franklin coming out?
Oh, God, I've just been working on it so long. One or two more. But let's see if we can find something a little classier than that.
Okay.
This feels sort of like Family Feud up here, doesn't it?
I'm rejecting some.
I noticed that. Everybody's an editor.
Which of your characters do you relate to the most and the least?
Oh, I would say the one that I relate to the most would probably be Paul Sheldon from Misery. Because although I've never had my foot amputated or my thumb or anything like that, I've had any number of number one fans, and some of them, most of them are great, but every now and then there's somebody that's a little bit, you just say, whoa. But as far as... the character that I would relate to the least would, there are so many. So many people in my stories that I don't want to be like, and it's so disturbing to think that I created them on some level out of myself. There's Kurt Dussander from App Pupil, the horrible Nazi, one character. Pennywise the Clown from It. There is a little bit of Randall Flagg in me, but I think there's a little bit of Randy Flagg in everybody. He's from The Stand. Maybe the character I relate to the least would be Big Jim Rennie, the politician in Under the Dome, because he's just so awful but so plausible to me, because with the political setup what it is in America today, it's just too easy. There's so much hate, there's so much anger. And one of the reasons for writing the Kennedy book, I think, was because at that time in Dallas, and the atmosphere that surrounded the president before the assassination was so ugly and so charged. And I thought about writing this book again, it was around the second year of the Obama administration, and I saw all this sort of disconnect between the political parties and real anger, real rage. It's very disquieting to me. I'm not going to get up on any kind of political hobby horse at all, but just to say, when you have a president who's sort of disregarded as weak because he's looking for consensus, there's something very wrong somewhere. One more.
Your audience members would like to know how many times you might have started a project and not finished it for some reason.
There's quite a few. There's quite a few different stories and novels that are sitting around that are unfinished. I'm going to say probably 40, something like that. And some of them are really good. Some of them are not. There's a story called The Plant that was published online, and I don't know how to finish it. But there's a wonderful half-finished novel called, get ready for this, this is really purple. The novel was called Hatchet Head. And it was about a teenage boy who was doing a term paper on capital punishment. And this one particular inmate who is executed, and then after he's been executed, he starts writing this kid letters and saying, I'm coming to see you. And murders along the way with the same MO, but I couldn't figure it out, so. I got about 150 pages in stock. Listen, you guys have been so great to me. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Let's actually give him the award, and then you can do all that all over again. I'd like to bring out the mayor of the city of Fairfax, Rob Lederer.
Thank you. Well, let me again welcome you all, certainly to the city of Fairfax, but George Mason University in the fall for the books. It's my honor tonight to present Mr. King with the Mason Award. You know, it's really amazing that when you look at everything he's done, and as I was sitting out on the street watching you all come in, I was amazed at the variety of the age of the folks that came out tonight to hear him. It's not very often, most of the time when I bring my kids, they're backstage that are 12 and 13 year olds to a political event, usually I have to bring them kicking and screaming. Tonight they were in the car 10 minutes early and honking the horn because they were afraid they were gonna be late. Their favorite book, and they know you best for the It, and my daughter backstage, Brooke, just proclaimed that she had been, quote, with a big smile on her face, scarred for life after she saw the movie, so that's quite a testament. The award is named George Mason, one of the founding fathers of the U.S. from whom the university also takes its name. The author of the Virginia Declaration of Rights, Mason is known for the father of the Bill of Rights and served as an early proponent of freedom of speech. The Mason Award serves as a reminder of Mason's ideas and efforts and celebrates the freedom of speech he helped secure. Stephen King is one of the world's most successful writers. He made his first professional short story sale in 1967. In the fall of 1973, he began teaching high school English classes in Hampton Academy, the public high school in Hampton, Maine. Writing in the evenings and on the weekends, he continued to produce short stories and to work on novels. In the spring of 1973, Doubleday Company accepted the novel Carrie for the publication, providing him with the means to leave teaching and to write full time. He has since published over 50 books, including most recently the collection Full Dark, No Stars, and has become one of the world's most successful writers. He and his wife, novelist Tabitha King, are regular contributors to a number of charities, including many libraries, and have been honored for their philanthropic activities. It is my pleasure to present Mr. King with the 2011 Mason Award, which recognizes and honors his literary career, which spanned 40 years, from his Dubé novel, Carrie, through his forthcoming novel, 11-22-63, a time-traveling adventure surrounding the JFK assassinations, and is due out in November this year, so watch your bookstores. Before I actually present him the plaque, it's my understanding that you're an enthusiastic Patriot supporter in basketball and our basketball program. One of the greatest honors I've had as mayor was to present the Final Four team with the key to the city. And while I don't tonight have the key to the city, the university has given me a George Mason University basketball hat and t-shirt that I'd like to present.
Swag!
I love it.
And last but certainly not least, the Mason Award.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you all. That's terrific. Thanks. Thank you very much.